this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. And today what you're going to get is the June update at Super Seth's Super Garden here. But what I want to do is actually, I wasn't even here to film it because I was out of town. So we got the Boogie Broy Josh filming it along with Seth. And in that episode, they're going to show you guys the update on how things are growing. But then more importantly, they're going to get into some Korean natural farming and fermented plant juices that I know a lot of you guys have asked me about Korean natural farming before, and I definitely agree with it. And any way to improve your soil, whatever technique or label you want to put on, I think is great. And that's what you guys are going to learn in this episode. So let's get right to it.
This is John Cola the Boogie Boy, reporting to you on a beautiful Sunday afternoon in June. Thank you, No June Gloom, today from Super Seth's backyard food forest and medicine garden. Trying to do a little tour. Seth himself, Super Seth, thank you for having us here, by the way. Leah and I are proud to be here. Tried to give me a whirlwind tour, and I can't remember half of what he told me, so we're gonna have him in person visiting some of the techniques that he's doing here. And of course this, I was just here, it seems like, barely a few weeks ago, and I don't even recognize this. The red hot cookies. And she's red hot, look at that. And apparently he says that he can't keep up with grooming her. And I mean, good Lord, look at that stalk. You know, that's TD level, that's next level. And I believe this is a full termer, which is scary because Super Seth is not like going for it as a TD level sport. He's trying to, you know, be a little more discreet, shall we say. About his backyard crop. And so this is clearly a great problem to have, but it's problematically large for this early into the summer period. And absolutely perfect. Picasso couldn't paint a finer shade of green on these leaves. Stunning, stunning early flower development. I'm suspecting that Red Hot Cookies is a quick finisher, judging by how stout her pre-flower node sites are forming. I mean, that's just the perfect plant. And it's got a healthy fly here. I mean, there's some great biology going on here. He's got soil that you could make love to. I'm gonna ask Super Seth for his top tip, the SLS tip. What's your top tip for the best living soil? Which clearly, I'd say the problem with Super Seth is that he has too many tips. And this gentleman is a super sponge of information and knowledge. And then he applies it beautifully, might I add, in a fashion that any artist would be proud of. This, to me, is the ultimate example of a backyard food forest and medical farm all in one. Grown as sustainably as it gets, as clean, green, lean, and mean of a beautiful soil machine that this gentleman, let me smell that. Let me get a whiff. I could make love to good soil biology. Oh, good God, that is just to die for. That's so nice. And this one, full gas. And she's also going full bloody gas. And then look at this, it's just so cute. I'm gonna munch on a boogie berry here because I do believe he's been feeding him tea. Super Seth adopts Grizz's mantra, low and slow. So that's the thing, none of this has been overfed, even though it looks like it was, it must have maybe gotten some pure protein or something. That's not legal to have such gorgeous leaf tissue formation, such healthy berries. And I'm gonna munch on one. Oh, that is a terpene. That's a terpegasm, man. That's incredible. Like, And this can only bode for what other fruits and bricks levels are coming down the Seth, Super Seth garden pipeline. And by the way, let me just pause before going on after enjoying the most delicious strawberry ever. Thanks, Super Seth. I'm doing this because John's and Seth's schedules didn't line up. So we're reporting basically on behalf of JK. This is JK's visit, but with the Boogie Boy instead. So yeah, this gorgeous tomato plant next to the berry patch. And then over here, something I would never recognize. And this is called Freak Show. And she's cannabis, believe it or not. I mean, she looks like cilantro or some sort of aquatic, you know, riparian habitat. You know, grass species that would grow next to my meadow in Humboldt. And she doesn't look like a cannabis plant, but she's called Freak Show. And she's freaky in a really good way. Like the Michael Franti song, all the freaky people make the beauty of the world. All the freaky Freak Show kind of little wonder plants. And apparently this is HSC seed, so this is gonna do something, you know, that's worthy of, for sure. Not just like, oh, I grew a freaky plant. Humboldt Seed Company wouldn't create Freak Show if it didn't have, I'm sure, freaky results. So yeah, that's pretty exciting. Right here in the raised bed, little eco zone of Super Seth's patch here. He's got all kinds of his greens still raging. And then he has a whole line here of some new runts that he decided to put in.
Peyote Skittles.
Yeah, this is the Peyote Skittles. And we'll get some reports from him on what she's supposed to do. The triplets. We have a Peyote triplet Skittles here. Another super happy, healthy tomato. Everywhere I look, I just see. And then he's got Super Steve C's, you know, formula for healthy IPM management, always to companion plant. So look at these marigolds. Just gorgeous. I mean, that's like art. So yeah, Seth agreed with me that he would get a little more on point here about what's going on, including a whole wine barrel zone I missed, which already has some fat boogie berries. Look at that.
Exactly.
The squash behind it is nuts.
Yeah.
What's going on there,
These
dude?
Are volunteer squashes, man.
No.
I think they're Costata Romanesco zucchinis, but some of these just popped up this year.
Dude.
From the compost, because I composted some of my Costata Romanescos last year. And what I had in
Wait,
here was...
Wait, what are they? Repeat that?
It's weird to pronounce. It's Costata Romanesco zucchini. It's an Italian variety of zucchini. They have like little like veiny sort of stuff on the outside. They're really tasty. They're really good. You get them when they're about that big. They're really tender. I like to like fry them up in a little bit of oil. It's super good.
Wow. Yeah, they're tasty. How did you identify them? You just know?
I just guessed the way that they're growing because I planted this one from seed this year, so I'm positive that this is a Costata Romanesco. They look similar enough. I'm just guessing at this point. But I think it is. Yeah.
That is incredible.
Yeah, isn't that cool?
Yeah.
And then, man, I mean, so I had an autoflower up here, and I just harvested that, but I was growing the autoflower. That was a critical 2.0.
Do I get to sample that?
Sure, of course, yeah. If it's any good, I'll give you some. It's not done curing yet, but yeah, this is kind of like my little side plot. It's not one of the raised beds. So, you know, I've got some CBD in here. I've got my Japanese wine berries in here. This is
Wait,
a really
so this plant. This is kind of like your leftover?
A little bit. Well, kind
of. Look at it. It's so prime.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, every time I have an extra strawberry plant, I plant it wherever there's a little bit of room. And now, you know, man, I'm like, I'm about to cash in on that. I mean, you can see if you check
this
out.
Yeah, give me another boogie berry.
Random berries all over the garden.
Super
safe. Yeah, that one's maybe not quite as ripe as your previous one.
That last one was so good.
Yeah, that was prime. Good stuff, man.
Oh, I like that. That was even...
Rad.
Equally awesome, but yeah.
And yeah, this is a...
So rad, dude.
This is another feminized plant. This is another full gas right here. So, you know, who knows what will happen to these. I don't think that the soil is quite as sweet right here as it is in the garden beds, because this is much newer soil. Mm. So we'll see how it goes. But yeah, these plants seem really happy. And only problem is you see a little bit of curl. That's a little too much nitrogen on this one. But other than that, I think these plants are pretty happy.
What happened? Too much pure protein?
I think I put too much pure protein.
It's actually possible to overdo it, huh?
I'll find a way, yeah.
Once every 2 weeks. Yeah. Even Super Seth, Mr. Low and Slow. This is your leftover, like, screw it, let's see what happens kind of.
A little bit.
I
definitely take the beds a little more seriously, and I know that the soil is a little, you know, a little more developed in those beds.
Yeah, but this is epic.
This is a whole
new mound of bio
in
the making.
Totally.
Like, why leave this real estate?
Yeah.
You know, why not populate it with
Seth's leftovers.
Yeah, it's full sun.
Yeah.
So here, let's keep moving this way, and I'll give a little more tour. So yeah, like I was saying, Costata Romanesco zucchini, definitely my favorite variety of zucchini, not only to grow because it's beautiful, but also to eat because it's delicious. These are the French marigolds. Shout out to our boy, Super Steve Cantwell, who I, of course, have never met, but I love his growing style, and he swears by the French marigold. He also swears by the dichondra. Do you know that? It's like, it looks a little bit like a clover, but not really, and it's like a ground cover that he uses in his.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try some dichondra. I think it's dichondra. I'm going to try that in the garden this year, but I haven't planted any yet.
No, you've always kept stuff growing in these beds.
All year, yeah.
Now, what have you added recently?
I've added...
But you're always adding.
Sure, well, I'm always piling stuff
something,
on top.
Something new is growing in it, which is adding by its own
exactly.
Nitrogen fixing and all that good stuff. So you always keep stuff going. Never leave stuff fallow.
Yeah.
Find something to plant in there. Keep that microbial web of life exchange.
Always have armor on your soil so that what's going on below it, you know, can reach its full potential. You don't want it exposed to the sun too often because that'll destroy the life inside your soil. So what I've done recently, I put on a little bit of worm castings, and then I also just take my lawn clippings and I put them on top. It's a little bit of extra nitrogen, and it also keeps a little barrier on
top
of the soil.
So that's all you've added?
No, I mean, I add stuff all the time, but but that's the most recent addition.
Okay, since John was here.
Yeah. What do you think? I don't even know. I don't quite.
You are Mr. Low and Slow. You don't go crazy with top dressings. You're just harvesting what's in your own yard from your compost bin with your worms.
No, but I use fertilizer for sure. Like organic fertilizer, of course. But like I use, you know, like Coast of Maine, the lobster meal.
Yeah, I heard nothing but good things about Coast of Maine.
Yeah, Coast of Maine is good.
Vegan mix. We got you some vegan mix.
Yeah, BioLive.
BioLive is badass.
Yeah, BioLive is great fertilizer.
We have a lot of people that love BioLive. Yeah, thank you,
and
Down to Earth.
That's in Boogie Brew, right? BioLive is in Boogie Brew.
No, but it's not. We sell a lot of BioLive.
Okay, cool.
No, but Down to Earth, of course, a lot of their products are in our team. Mm-hmm.
We
love them. They're the best.
Down to Earth is excellent.
They are. So has this had any of the vegan mix or BioLive since any of this stuff? Or is this
I think it has.
Okay, but very little, just like a salt and pepper amount?
Yeah, exactly. Every time I add it, you know,
Low and slow.
I'm going really low, like... You know, if I think it's a strong fertilizer, I'll put like a tablespoon in and just mix it into a bunch of worm castings and then feed the worm castings. And like, I do keep it really low and slow. I mix a lot of my fertilizers into the worm castings before I feed the worm castings.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So the worms get to digest it too.
Exactly. And also like, you know, it's not like one plant is getting a ton of one thing. It's like every plant's getting a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
So see, I got, you know, arugula here. I'm sure that's putting some delicious root exudates into the soil and helping feed the rest of the cannabis plant. This is my largest freak show plant this year. I was gonna top it, but I'm like, I don't know anything about this plant. I think I'm just gonna let it do its thing, you know what I mean? Because it's so weird, it's so unique, it's so different.
Dude, that freak show is awesome.
I know. And I've heard people say
we know nothing about it. It's so new that there's not much, you can't go find results of it already.
People say there's a lot of terpenes. People say it tastes really good, but no.
Talking about terpenes, that is insane.
Yeah, this is really good.
Dude, that is off the chain how good that arugula tastes. Good Lord.
Leah, you'll have to get something done filming.
Anything you enjoy out of here, no matter how you consume it.
Spicy.
Dude. Seriously. Bro, that is like, wow.
I know. Mm-hmm. Crazy. Mm. And then check it out. That's next to the native tobacco. So this tobacco is native to Northern California. This particular one was found in Bolinas, California. And this is the native tobacco. So I grow this alongside the rest of the plants. And John Kohler ate it last time he was here, which was hilarious.
Dude, Bolinas is where the world's first certified organic farm.
Yeah.
This gentleman's woven into the deep social fabric of the roots of the West Marin horticultural consciousness. This is as ground zero as it gets. We're reporting to you from the bosom of the 707 Grow Code right here in Sonoma, man.
Yeah, man.
Which is a global epicenter of horticultural thought leadership. And this gentleman embodies all of that.
Thank you, man.
And just beautifully. It's not what we do. It's how we're going about doing it. So although he's... Super Seth, a super nerd about all this, he does it so, like the way he skates, you know, just, you get in motion, it keeps your brain out of any commotion, and this is your garden escape
yeah, man.
That you've put energy into, and just the right amount, I can tell.
Yeah, this is where I cruise, yeah. Man.
You cruise, exactly. This is where I cruise. Yeah, this is where he skates, right here.
So I added a bunch of lupin to this because I love lupin. I love the way it flowers. I think it's. I also love the palm style leaf. You know, like the leaf is like they call that a palm style leaf. I just think it's such a beautiful plant. And so later in the season, this will go into flower and it'll have these big, long, tall flowers that I really love.
And great companion plants.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, and these are all volunteer sunflowers this year.
Yeah, I was wondering about those.
Yeah. So they just popped up really early this year, and I was like, man, these sunflowers are way too beautiful. I can't get rid of them. So I'm going to wait for them to flower, and then I'm just going to chop under the base and plant more, like, whatever, tomatoes and kale and stuff over there, because they're just getting so crazy.
In about a month, those will, when we revisit, they'll be...
It might be less than a month,
look at
it's
that.
It's really coming.
I couldn't get a look at them earlier.
No,
I know. Now that you show me...
They're huge, man.
The development.
They're huge, and they're going to grow more. I mean, it's crazy.
That's volunteer.
Yes.
So that's what happens when you make your main cash crop, the living soil, that you grow.
So much.
You make the soil the main thing that you grow, and then guess what? Whatever plants are nearby to it,
exactly.
Volunteer or deliberately planted or thoughtfully companionably planted, they're going to dance.
Happy worm, happy soil, these are happy plants.
Soil life is all life, bro.
Absolutely.
And I feel like... I shouldn't even be in my sandals. I should be walking, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I should be barefoot on this wonderful bed of bio that we've done here.
Here, let's keep moving. Let's go to this next one. Yeah. This is the Persian cucumber right here. That's my favorite type of cucumber. I think they're delicious. See, we got a little baby one right there. These are really good. We just pluck them off fresh. Me and my wife will just come out here and pluck a fresh cucumber and munch on it.
What variety of cucumber?
This is Persian cucumber. Persian. I think it's called Beet Alpha. Whatever official name or whatever, but I call it Persian cucumber. And of course that's next to the calendula, which is about to flower. See, you can see right in there, this calendula is about to get going.
Another,
and that's next
awesome
to the tomato
companion plant.
Yeah, calendula is great because apparently
against
it will
bugs.
Yeah, push bugs away. And then, like you were just saying, these are the peyote skittles. These are some, they grow really beautifully.
When did you put them in?
That was a
few days ago?
No, a couple weeks ago.
Oh, it's been a couple of weeks already.
I planted them when they were really small.
Wow.
Because I just wanted to get them outside. I was sick of having them in. And it hasn't been very warm recently, so they're starting off a little slow, but they'll catch up. And then, speaking of starting off slow, all these tomatoes, I mean, on a normal year, these would already be up to the trellis, but for some reason, you know, this year, I think they're calling it a La Nina year or something.
El Nino's coming.
Oh, yeah.
Well, no, I think it's still La Nina, and then El Nino's going to hit with a vengeance.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, it's been uncharacteristic. This is the coolest spring we've ever had.
It's very cold, yeah. So today's a gorgeous day. We're blessed to have this.
Yeah,
but
most days be June gloom. Yeah?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Most days, like 60 degrees and just cloudy and stuff. So anyway, that's why it's not super popular
yeah,
now.
Yeah, but we could visit in a month, and things could look very different indeed.
Yeah, it'll warm up.
Was
eventually.
That another volunteer?
I think... I've lost track of which ones are volunteers and which ones I planted because...
So beautiful.
Yeah, they're
Look
crazy.
At the purple tones in the stalk.
Yeah, because I like to plant like red and black sunflowers a lot of the time. And yeah, I always try to find the weirdest variety. It's like, I don't want to just grow boring sunflowers. I want to grow crazy.
Why not have fun with it?
Yeah. So, Leah, if you look over here, this is what I want a lot of my garden to look like, you know? I want the French marigolds up against the kale with a volunteer sunflower, some arugula, some tomatoes, you know, just all this biodiversity in here right next to this cannabis plant so that, you know, all these plants are going to send down different root exudates and they're going to feed the soil in different ways, and then that will allow very unique terpenes to be in my plants, right? You know what I'm saying?
Using... the microbial matrix, the web of life below the ground and above it.
Yes.
So everything that is wrong with mechanized monocrop farming, and we're going to go visit California's Dust Bowl at some point. You and I should do that together.
We should.
Yeah, because that's happening everywhere. Like, and this is how never to have a dusty soil that just blows away.
Yeah.
And just do how nature would do it, you know? I mean, duh. So everything that's wrong with that mechanized form of horticulture, you do in the equally opposite extreme end of doing it right. It's not what we do, it's how we go about doing it. Super Seth knows how to do it. Seriously.
Radical, dude. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm so impressed.
Well, we'll keep rocking around here. This is a table queen acorn squash, I think. So I'm looking forward to that. I realized I was buying acorn squashes, and there was like this one grocery store that was selling them each for like $3 or $4.
Holy moly.
I know. I was like, I can't believe that. So I'm trying to grow my own acorn squashes this year. I probably eat less than 6 a year, so maybe I'll just I'll have all the acorn squashes I need, you know? Yeah. Who knows?
I'd love to try one if you have an extra one you can't eat.
Man, you can have as many as you want.
Beats paying $3.
I know, right? And my wife loves them as well. I think they're like a really delicious,
The price of food.
I know.
Come on.
Inflation.
It's enough to piss off the Pope.
Yeah, man.
So, save hundreds, thousands on your food bill.
Sometimes people come over and they think that this is a diseased lettuce, but it's not. This is how the lettuce is supposed to look. It's a purple lettuce. It's a freckled purple lettuce.
Italian type of...
One of those heirloom Italian... a little more bitter than a normal lettuce, but it's really tasty.
Probably really medicinal.
Mm-hmm. A little bit of anthocyanin in there, I think.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Not quite as exciting as the...
That tastes as good as it looks weird.
Yeah, man. It's a very strange lettuce.
Freak show lettuce. Wow. What's it called?
I just call it freckled lettuce. I forget exactly what the name is.
Dude, anything that I can eat out of this place tastes better than, Michelin restaurants.
Thank you, man.
Or any even, organic section of a health food store aisle. Like, this is next level.
Well, I think it's pretty rare
how good everything tastes out of this place.
Yeah. It's pretty rare that a farmer would have the same incentives as the consumer,
Right.
They want to get, even if it's an organic farmer, and, all the love to the farmers, but they want the product as cheap as they can produce it to show up in the store fresh. I don't think that, it would be hard to sell, a head of this lettuce. It doesn't really grow in heads the way that Americans want their head of lettuce, their photogenic piece of lettuce. Like, this isn't that. This is a really unique, weird one, and I, give it all the love that I can, and give it sort of unique fertilizers and sometimes boogie brews, sometimes anaerobic fertilizers, all this other stuff. And so it is going to taste different. Your inputs eventually are your outputs in a garden.
We're going to talk about your anaerobic ferments.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to visit that as well as the vermigasm.
Exactly. So normally me and Josh are aerobic bros, right?
Pretty much. I'm an aerobic nut. Yeah. I mean, that's my business. I don't speak anaerobic language, even though I respect it.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that some people say, you got to do anaerobic or you got to do aerobic. And what I think is you got to have variety. And Josh does a great job distributing, aerobic fertilizer throughout the United States. Everyone with the air pumps in the compost tea.
It's not a fertilizer. It's a soil amendment. But you're feeding your soil the ultimate high octane fuel additive.
Yeah.
But he's using lactobacillus and anaerobic ferments in K&F farming. Now, one of my local customers, Scott, Super Scott, he competed with his roommate on who could grow the best cannabis plants in their little humble patch backyard. And his roommate was 100% K&F.
Uh-huh.
And he was 100% boogie.
Okay.
Making tea every week, practicing, all the mantras, the 9/11 rules.
Mm-hmm.
The other guy's like, I don't even have a boogie budget.
Right.
I'm going to do K&F.
Yeah.
And just as crude and as cheap as some struggling North Korean farmer just trying to get out of town, and make and hand to mouth, right? And guess what? At the end, the results were super close.
Really? Okay, cool.
But my bros definitely, of course I'm biased, so I'm not going to say which
so
one. Right. I mean, but then they came and revisited it where I'm like, F that. Let me sponsor him if he's too broke to afford tea, Because Scott shares. I'm into the sharing economy.
Of course.
And so when, of course, he rocked them both.
Yeah, yeah.
Like you're doing.
Yeah.
And at the right times, it's not what we do. It's how we go about doing it, right?
Yeah.
Why would you pour an aerobic, all these delicate microbes right near a totally dominator-infused anaerobic on the same day.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, why would you spray neem oil if you had a bug problem to begin with, which I know you evidently, don't.
Not right now, but I'm going to do some IPM this year.
You wouldn't do that, the neem and Bronner soap on the same day as a rinse-off spray with tea, So I think obviously marrying them, right?
And, sure.
Not, of course, like I said, I am biased.
Yeah.
I have to disclaim that. But I'm going to say it now, straight up. If you can't afford teas, don't worry. It's not like, now I suck. Now my garden's not going to rage. Because, like I said, the results were ridiculously close. Just like I've seen guys who were out in the patch, like deep gorilla growers, and the only thing they could bring with them was pure protein powder.
Right.
And otherwise they're relying on where a bunch of blackberries used to be, and they just pulled every one of them and used salt and vinegar and torched their roots in the deep in the woods, right? And all they did was come back and do pure protein sprays because they didn't have the backpacking logistics ability of bringing teas in,
and
even sacks of top dressings, right? They're like, wow. F it, we're going native. One high octane thing we'll use is the PP, you know, Dunn's a foliar on this one. And they did killer, you know, more than respectable results.
Amazing.
Right? What would have easily passed for AAA back in the day.
Sure.
Of course, now we have new levels of excellence.
You could also attribute that partially because it sounds like they were growing in native soil.
Exactly. Yeah, there's so great. Much to be said. Queen of the sun grown.
She
just
she
can't,
sounds,
we
yeah.
can't reiterate that enough, you know? And so much of what you have here. This is your native grass clippings.
Yeah, yeah.
There's native leaf mold from your compost bin that even JK himself was blown away by how effect. He's like, wow, you know, talk about a cobbled together wonder.
Right.
Wonder
right.
barrel, you know, yeah. of bio. So, but using salt and pepper level stuff like you do, low and slow, no matter what you do, whether you do the teas and the top dressings or you come in there with your K&F preps, which we're going to visit in a minute.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is great to be your scholar, you know. You know, I'm eager to learn this from you.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll finish up the tour and then I'll show everyone how to make some Korean natural farming, some free fertilizer for your gardens.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, like, you just enjoyed a strawberry out of here. This is the strawberry patch.
Such a good berry. Can I have one more?
Dude, you can have as many as you want. If you find them, it's yours.
Oh,
man.
Dude, look
Everything
at this.
Everything edible here is for everyone.
This is so good.
So, yeah. I mean, you already went over this. I love purple kale. I think it grows really beautifully. It tastes really good. The anthocyanin, I think, is, you know, there's some health benefits there. Who knows?
Health is your wealth.
There you go.
This guy's a millionaire back here. Seriously.
Thanks, man. Yeah. And then also you'll probably notice I put all this this like drip irrigation tubing all over, so you know if it ends up getting warmer, I'll be able to rely on this.
You have that.
Yeah, exactly.
Are you mostly dry farming right now?
Not really. I mean I come through here.
There's a lot of drainage out of these beds.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. And also there's a lot of drainage in the soil. So it dries out.
I've been visiting TDs.
Yeah.
And we're going to have on the Boogie channel, cuz Seth does a great job of taking all of my Boogie babble. And we're going to have it distilled down into an update and just some reports and teas. But he's going 100% dry farm this year.
That's wild. That's
and
wild.
And they're doing amazing.
That's
I think
sick.
I texted you a little video.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're just, he's like, wow, you know.
Yeah.
And he did exactly what I told him to, like, do, because he left to go to Oregon and accidentally overwatered his plants.
Mm-hmm. So you got biochar and insect frass?
Came in there, gave him biochar, frass, some neem seed meal, just in case. I told him to be ready with a product called MycoStop if he needed it.
Mm-hmm.
But they didn't mind, and now he's left everything alone. He literally hasn't hit them since the accident. Nothing.
Oh my God,
he sticks
amazing.
His meter in there, and it's like 9, 10.
Whoa, okay.
And
so
they're just And they're going crazy. His plan is to maybe not water at all.
Amazing.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
And can you imagine the terps?
I know.
Dry farming will give you the best terps.
Pulling all that out of the ground.
You know, you do everything Super Seth does and then combine it with utter dry farming.
Yeah.
Like if you were even more blessed than he already is with his backyard wonder bed, you know, farm, and you have the ability to do it like in the right place, you know, I'm talking about like the meadow at our property up north,
right,
begging to be dry farm, floodplain produce kind of thing.
Totally.
And the terps you get, if you do everything you do and combine that with Bellina style dry farming, baby.
Pretty sick, man.
Yeah, that
pretty
would be good terps. Yeah, so we got even
it's a little,
higher.
It's too dry here. I can't do that.
But still, you practice it. Essentially.
I do very light water.
Right. You're probably, this is less moist. I bet if you stuck a meter in here now, it would be less moist than his is.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Who knows?
That feels like about a 7. Well, who knows?
Yeah, I can't
use my finger to tell me. But
no,
you know what I mean?
Kinda.
It's definitely not overwatered.
Right, right.
You would never do that.
So then, yeah, these are the rest of the ladies. You know, this one I've been talking about all year. This is, like, such a crazy plant. Just like Josh was saying, I can't keep it defoliated. So I'm always trying to, you know, bring a little bit of leaf material off the plant. If it's too crowded inside, I want air to be able to circulate all around the plant and avoid things like molds growing on the plant. And so I swear, I come out here, I pull leaves off this thing almost every day when I'm out here, you know? It's just, it grows so vigorously.
The more you pull, the more she'll come right back.
It's true, man.
It's like she's taunting you.
She is.
Yeah.
So far, this is a great plant, man.
Yeah,
so,
beauty.
So, yeah.
When is she supposed to finish?
I don't know. I'm going to look it up later in the season
out,
for all the different plants, but for now, it's just veg mode right now, so I don't
I'm
really
reckoning no later than the end of September.
I hope so.
Full termer, right?
Yeah. Photo period.
Everything here is full term?
Yeah, most of the autoflowers are out now. So everything we've seen today is a photo period, full term plant.
When you said you had some autoflower produce for me.
Oh, yeah. Well, not right now, because I got to let it cure.
Yeah, of course. It's getting delay gratification.
Exactly.
TD apparently has some blueberry cupcake he's teasing me to come and get.
Sick, man.
Yeah, it is sick. It's like getting to have our cake and eat it too in June.
Yeah, yeah.
Just to have that little, you know, flavor party at the beginning of summer.
To me, it hasn't been warm enough to properly finish like a really good autoflower yet.
Okay,
like you can get some okay bud from autoflower if it's been foggy out.
They were very forgiving, or they didn't like it. They really wanted some sun.
They wanted a hot day. They wanted a bunch of hot days. That's just what cannabis loves, you know?
Yeah,
that's how it's done. Anyways, let's go make some Korean natural farming ferments, right? Let's check it out.
So, as you know, I shamelessly speak aerobic language because Boogie Brew is AACT, which is actively aerated compost tea. However, compost tea back in the day, in the Findhorn days, would have been a preparation that's utterly anaerobic. And guess what? When that's prepared properly and allowed to complete its fermentation process, the end result can work equal wonders on your garden, on your soil. And so what was called AACT has, you know, originally to distinguish itself from old-fashioned farmers, if you want to call it that, compost tea is now, you know, unfortunately, I think it's sad that compost tea is sort of widely viewed as being an AACT, like a Boogie Brew. So anaerobic can be very beneficial because it consists of, it's like digesting like the fish hydrolysate, the pure protein, for instance. You know, you're breaking everything down, which is like how arguably the black soldier fly frass is almost an anaerobic level dominator infused, you know, antibiotic. It's almost anaerobic, can be antibiotic almost, you know, by the time you've fermented things properly and you end up with the beneficial strains that you get from, you know, like a lactobacillus preparation, which Seth's about to, I'm sorry, I just don't want to ramble on about aerobic versus anaerobic, but they are clearly distinct, and I want to go back to the, you know, the separation that I think is good. Today's not a tea day. Leah, if you show the camera over here, his tea bucket is idle. Now, I'm like, well, why is
it's
it
just
idle?
Normal water.
Yeah, he's
boring old normal water and not aerating it either. Or maybe a little aeration, but nothing major.
Now, you can add some vinegar to that to disinfect everything.
Sure.
But that poor compost tea bucket is sitting there idle, doing nothing. However, when I asked him that, why is it idle? Why is there no Boogie Brew going? Well, today's an anaerobic day.
Yes.
So if you know, this is Sunday, a chill day. Let the tea clean itself over there. Gas off the air stone, all that. And go for your K&F full lab nerd level anaerobic preparation.
Yeah.
So let's get into that. You've got a couple of different ones, and
this is the
backyard, the utterly free, the one that costs nothing.
So we're gonna do two anaerobic ferments today. One is gonna be totally free, and the other one is gonna be really cheap, but not quite free. So this is comfrey. I grow it in my yard. I think it's native to like Europe and Russia and stuff, and people use it as medicine a lot of the time. I know that there's a lot of medicinal benefits, but the other thing that people use it for is as like an accumulator species. Like it'll send a taproot way deep down, like 10 feet into the ground, and it'll like gather all those minerals and put it into its leaves. So these leaves are like very, you know, nutritionally dense leaves. So what you can do is you chop this all up into a bucket, and then you add a little bit of water and you let it sit for like 3 or 4 weeks. And then when it's done with that, all of these leaves, you know, they're very thin and papery, they'll just fall apart in the water. So the plant basically disappears and it all gets totally integrated into the water as it's fermenting. And then when you pour that on your plants, you're giving them like this infusion of all these different nutrients that have just been breaking down and fermenting in the bucket, right?
Comfrey is also a super plant food. In its own right, completely separate from tree. And then going to its medicinal values, like the Romans used to bring it onto their battlefields with them for their soldiers healing their wounds quicker, because one of its medicinal properties for humans is allantoin, which heals bones.
That's amazing. And I have no idea.
Yeah, but you don't want to ingest it. John will tell you on his raw channel. You don't want to do it long term because comfrey can be hard on the human liver if you were to go crazy. You know, it is medicinal. It's got medicinal value and should be respected as such.
Okay, so you're getting right into it. Than me. These scissors are a little dull, but we're getting through it. So I'm just going to chop this stuff all up into here.
I just ate some of the flour and it's delicious.
Really? What does it taste like?
It tastes really good. You should try some before you make old ferment.
Like this or no, a fresher one. These are like dead flour.
Yeah, I got the one on top. It's so good with a little purple.
I see one down here. All right, let's try this.
So good. Yeah, some allantoin. Dude, I told you. Yeah, don't give it all to the microbes.
Yeah, man. Let the humans have some and the microbes can have the rest. So anyway, this is going to fall apart in the water, so you don't need to be too precious about it. Comfrey is like a very
It didn't feel that papery thin to me. It feels pretty tough, but that's because it's a super Seth plant.
Well, the bottom line is it falls apart in the water, you know.
It dissolves really quick.
It really does, yeah.
Wow, I can't wait to come back and see it.
I know. Well, the nice thing is I made one a while back, so we'll be able
to
show
off. One. Okay,
yeah, we'll be able to show off the final product today.
How old is that one, a month?
No, so that one's faster because I added sugar to that one. Oh. So that one's 4 days old. I think when you add sugar,
you can make this stuff in 4 days.
I think so. I mean, usually people say wait a week or whatever. I don't know. We'll see how it's doing, and if it looks like it's been fermenting and it's all,
maybe wait another day or two.
We'll just take a look. We'll see how it is. But yeah.
So that's it. That's too easy.
Yeah. So you add
the stalks too.
Yeah. You add all this stuff and you add water. And then a lot of people will add sugar. I'm trying to make a free one right now. Sugar's not free. So.
So this definitely will take longer.
This will definitely take longer.
3 weeks.
I'd say a good 3 weeks on a non-sugary one. And the other thing I would do for this is.
Here, I'll donate some flowers back in.
There you go.
Yeah. I had just my medicinal dose there.
So you can rip all this up and then I'll go grab the water.
Yeah, I wonder if you shredded it, you know, if you had like a workhorse blender. Just if you're trying to go for a bit quicker or...
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Stuff just breaks down.
Exactly. So I'll be right back with the hose.
Check you out. That's a Super Seth wand right there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's nice.
So here, check it out, Leo. Let's get down into it. We're just going to fill it up to the top of the comfrey. We're making a small batch today. We don't need a ton.
Low and slow.
Low and slow, baby. That's all you need.
That
all
was
right.
Literally like one head of one comfrey plant.
Yeah, that's it. And then what I might do is I might, grab my shovel.
Now, I wonder if people do this with the dried comfrey that you can buy at health food stores.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't see why not.
I don't know. I bet it works better with the fresh leaves.
Smells good.
I bet there's something with the chlorophyll degradation and stuff that is actually needed for it to work right. It'd be an interesting experiment. Try just for shits and giggles to try one with some bulk comfrey like that you buy at Oliver's Market.
Yeah, totally. That's a good call.
Just say, oh, well, I did it with some comfrey. There's stuff I got on Amazon. There's dried stuff. I have a real hunch that you need the fresh stuff.
Yeah, I bet.
All right, so then grab a little plate.
Not much water at all.
Yeah, really not that much. It doesn't need much.
Yeah, here, let me keep getting it in there. I mean, that's going to dry right out. There's gonna be like a paste. This will just dehydrate.
Yeah. Maybe. I don't know.
The water, by the time you're done, especially if you're going for the longer, you're probably gonna need to add some water.
It'll have a cap though.
Yeah.
So check this out.
Oh, okay. And keep it all cap. Of course, that's part of the anaerobes.
In my kitchen.
Depriving it of oxygen. Yeah, sorry.
It's all good. So in my kitchen, when a plate gets cracked or chipped or whatever, I bring it into the garden.
No way.
And it fits perfectly inside of there.
That's sick.
So I'll just, you know, that lets a little bit of air in, but really not very much. Right. So that'll stay pretty anaerobic this whole time. And then when I'm done, I just pick it up like that. I think I'm actually going to go plate down.
What does that say on it?
Anthropology. This is where my wife got the plate. So anyways. Nice.
Thank you, wife.
Look at
that. Oh, I think the other way was better.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. All right, ready?
Yep.
That looks pretty cool. All right.
No, I get it. No, the way you had it first. Yeah, yeah.
Like
get
that.
It snug. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. All right, cool. So well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write a little label on this. I grabbed some tape, and today is June 11th.
He's stoner proofing it.
Exactly.
Document when it was made.
Oh.
Always.
Here you go.
Take 30 seconds to do this now. It's going to save you hours of heartache.
Comfrey, C-O-M-F-R-E-Y.
Good job. Right. Yep, that's
Comfrey.
Zero sugar.
K-N-F-R-E-Y. raw.
6 yeah. slash 11. There we go.
There you go. Like no sugar.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I'll say no sugar.
NS.
No sugar.
There you go. Yeah.
All right. Then
so
I
now you know that's
in like 3 weeks.
Exactly. July
come
4th.
Come back to this. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we'll
calm.
Have to visit July 4th weekend and inspect your fresh head of comfrey. Garden hose water, yeah. filtered water, mm-hmm. a donated plate, and the bottom of a Home Depot bucket.
Yep.
And it's going to produce an ultra-high-grade anaerobic ferment
yeah.
that is utterly beneficial for your garden.
Tons of good microbes.
It costs you $0.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's so awesome.
So now we'll move on. This is the free one. Now we're going to move on to the cheap one, but with a lot more cool ingredients.
So for our second batch of KNF, this is FPJ, by the way, fermented plant juice. That's what it's called. So FPJ, we're going to make a slightly more intense one that's maybe a little bit... a little bit more powerful, a few more ingredients. So the first thing I like to do is I like to start off by grabbing some rose petals. So let's check this out. Go over to any rose bush, any rose, and just pluck some petals off. Maybe don't pluck the ones right in the front of the plant so that, you know, it stays pretty, but these ones at the back, these aren't doing much. So I just grab all these rose petals, throw them in here, and if you get enough, well, actually, just a little fine, so you don't need a bunch, but yeah, just grab a little bit of rose petals.
Now, what if someone wasn't lucky enough to have a Super Seth charged rose?
Yeah.
Well, it's like a rose on steroids. Can they make it without the rose?
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So all of these ingredients are totally optional, you know? It's like,
yeah.
really what you're looking for is a bunch of plant matter mixed with a bunch of sugar, and then you just let that sit. That's the bottom line is you get a bunch of plant matter, get the sugar, and then just let it do its thing.
Oh, it smells so good.
Yeah, this is just a little supercharged version.
Let me smell that.
Yeah. So then check this out.
Oh, man.
Here, come with me really quick, Leo. Let's check this out. So everyone's got dandelions everywhere, right? Like, I find dandelions in between the cracks in my bricks. See this?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a dandelion petal. You got another. Oh, yeah, there's another. So here, hand that one to me. And then
the petals.
Just the flowers. Petals.
Okay.
And then follow me over here. Before Josh and Leah showed up today, I grabbed.
Oh, look at that! He's already
a bunch.
He already went walkies yeah. and found some. There
so that's a bunch
well,
of dandelion.
So that didn't cost anything.
Yeah.
Neither did the comfrey, and in
exactly.
your case, neither did the rose.
Well, how many people have roses? I mean, roses have got to be the most popular
flower. They're pretty
in the world,
ubiquitous,
right?
Yeah. But still.
Yeah. yeah. So then, I've also got the cannabis leaf. So take the cannabis leaf.
Again, this is plant matter that is
yeah.
free for the. They're begging you to please. Keep managing that canopy.
Exactly. So we've got cannabis leaf in there.
So he's returning the plant, you know, it's going full circle to feed its soil again.
Yeah.
Right there, as it's growing, with an interminable, you know, canopy that you can barely manage.
Yeah, so you can keep this a lot simpler, like I was saying, you know? That's why I wanted to do the first one as an example. All you really need is comfrey and water and an anaerobic situation. But if you want to get a little more fancy with it, you can add a bunch of cool ingredients and get an even more supercharged fertilizer.
And you could do it without comfrey too.
Yeah, oh yeah. So a lot
it's
of the time-
It's just plant matter and sugar.
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
A lot of the time people will make it out of pure dandelion, pure comfrey, or they'll even use like a local fruit, you know, like you can just take mm-hmm. a bunch of peaches and mash them up. And as long as you're not putting a bunch of peach pits that are viable into your garden, then you're totally good. And all that peach just becomes like delicious sugar for your plant to eat.
And all very medicinal too.
Totally, man.
Most of the ingredients he's using have medicinal values, you know.
Just about every plant has multiple uses.
Well, peach has the B17 and it's, you know, anti-cancer or whatever. Wow.
Yeah, right? Mm. It smells good, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
It smells excellent.
This is such a healthy batch of fresh, freshly harvested green leafy material. Yeah. Wonderful.
Excellent.
All the minerals.
Good.
You know? You can tell it's such a mineral dense. And I love that you're getting all those minerals for free, and they're dissolving easily, too, you know?
Yeah.
This paper-like... leaf that, like I said, I think it's tough right now, but
yeah, but
in
it,
no
it falls
time
apart.
It'll turn into cellulose that's just dissolving itself.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
All right,
oh, yeah.
And then another thing people like to do is they like to add various seeds. So, pumpkin seeds are well known, I think they're well known for being high in potassium, if I recall correctly. So, we'll take just a handful of pumpkin
zinc.
Seeds, Is it zinc? Okay.
Well,
cool.
Maybe both. I mean, that's what they're famous for, okay, for men, you know. When you get a bit older, Seth, you start thinking about your prostate.
Oh, okay.
So that's so it, again, another medicinal grade,
yeah,
superfood.
It's true.
Everything in here so far has been like, you know. And
speaking of superfood.
Yeah.
My favorite. This is raw hemp seed. So I'm going to take a little bit of this.
No way.
Not that it needs to be ground up any finer, but may as well, right? So in here we've got the dandelion, the pumpkin seed, and the hemp seed. And yeah, we're good to just throw that in. So I'm gonna bring the blender out here. We're gonna blend it up and then we're gonna add our inoculant, which is effective microorganism one. This is EM1. This is like
from Terraganic.
Yeah, yeah. This is a well-loved product in the living soil community. I'd say just about every living soil grower is gonna have this is gonna be their I have a bottle. I bought a bottle with some water in it, but at least it's EM1, it's good stuff, it's well loved by organic gardeners.
Exactly, that's an intelligent bottle right there.
Exactly, and yeah, it's pretty concentrated. You
right,
know, it says
it's not a single use.
Concentrated, they're not yeah, just shipping water all over the country, yeah, you know,
exactly,
they're doing it right.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna go grab the blender. So we've got, you know, it's not really that much stuff, it doesn't take much just to add a little bit of extra oomph to your KNF. So we're gonna get the blender all plugged in, and we're also gonna add a secret ingredient, some Boogie Black, everyone's favorite insect frass. So
that's some of the old stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So this Boogie Black is going to give us a little bit of like an inoculant, you know, it'll be like all of those organisms, the microorganisms on the outside of the BSFL that come along with it are gonna help infuse this little thing we've got going here, and it's gonna give it all the nutrients that it needs and all the little microorganisms that, you know, will populate it and then feed the soil eventually.
It's gonna keep it friendly microbes.
Yeah,
for sure.
Exactly. All right, yeah, here comes a loud noise.
Yeah, huh, that's I think not we, much. The hemp, yeah, it meals up quick.
I think we
that's
need to
part
add
of
some...
part of my secret for a good living hemp milk.
Oh, okay.
When you drink it, just pre-mill it like you just did. Not even for as long as you just did.
I'm gonna add some liquid
that's
to
all
this.
Those fatty acids.
I think it, wow, it wasn't really like blending the way I wanted it to. So
okay,
we'll see if
okay,
adding a little
Super,
bit of
Super Seth is not happy here. He's a perfectionist.
Well, the reason I do this is because I want the nutrients from the pumpkin seeds, but
yeah,
I don't want viable pumpkin seeds to be entering my garden and then just like
yeah.
You know,
making,
like if a pumpkin
sure
seed
it's really dissolved.
Exactly. Here goes.
Got it.
Okay, that's more like it.
All right.
Doesn't take much in the nutrients.
That's the super seed milk.
Exactly. Okay.
With the flowers.
Yeah.
The dandelion.
And the rose. Oh, yeah. I guess the rose is already in there. Okay.
Yeah. Look at that. Oh, man. What a waste.
Yeah. Hey, not if it goes to make
you
amazing plants.
Yeah, it's got the EM1. Man.
Yeah.
That's not a waste at all.
No, for sure. So then we're going to add some Boogie Black. This black soldier fly larva frass is, I think it's the best stuff in the world. I add it to just about everything. There we go. Oh, that's not the Intera. That's so funny.
That's the new one.
Yeah, this is the new stuff. You can tell just by the way
yeah,
it looks.
Yeah, that's the...
Because it's fed with beer grains, so it
yeah,
smells a little bit like fresh bread.
Yeah, it does. You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It smells pretty good, honestly.
Oh, it's great. It's good stuff.
So then a lot
more,
of the...
More protein in this one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then a lot of the time what people will do is they'll add sugar to their KNF solution in order to increase the microbial activity in there. So... What I do is when I go over to my parents' house or I go over to a good friend's house, I end up looking through their cabinets and I say, oh, you guys, come on, I'm sure you got a little bit of, you know, leftover expired sugar. Maybe you were trying to bake a pie 3 Thanksgivings ago and you still, for some reason, have some light brown sugar left over that's now been expired for 2 years. I grab that out of people's cabinets, only my good friends.
Old sugar.
Because that's weird to do to people you don't know well, right?
Right, but right.
I grab everyone's old sugar and I keep it as my garden sugar. So this is Super Seth's Ultimate Sugar Mix. This is just whatever sugar I could find from around. I'm trying to be as thrifty as possible.
This
exactly.
This is Super Seth scavenging
you can tell
sugar.
It is expired. Culture. You know, there's some weird little clumps in here, but the microbes aren't going to know the
yeah,
difference. They
exactly.
don't care. So I'll throw a bunch
might,
of this.
It might
in.
Even aged.
Right?
Yeah. Aged sugar might even be beneficial.
Right. And so the ratio that people go to is a 1-to-1 by weight. So if you want to get really official about this, you should weigh the plant matter you're putting in and then weigh the sugar you're putting in and have it just be a 1-to-1 ratio. It's super easy, but...
You think that was about 1-to-1?
No, not yet. I don't think there's enough in there yet. But
you're going to boost it.
I'm going to add some other stuff. So just to prove that you can use a bunch of different types of sugar, I'm going to go through all these different sugars that I've got. One type of sugar is fine. I bet a bunch of types of sugar is even better. That's just a guess, though. So this is some organic molasses that I use in my garden all the time. And I'll put a little...
Oh, that's a healthy dose.
Yeah, it's a nice bit of molasses.
A lot of calcium.
Yeah, man. And then Josh's favorite, the sucanate sugar. You recommended me this stuff the first time we talked.
Now distributes it. That's a good label.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
cool.
But they're affordable.
Sweet.
I'm glad
Sweet.
Now has it. It's good to know.
And then...
Oh, man, I can smell the molasses.
The molasses smells amazing.
The sucanate has a richer smell. It does. Ooh.
Now, for your one-stop shop, for your sugar, you want to get all your bricks in one place.
That's...
Plus the maxi crop is in this.
There's amino acids in there.
Yeah, this is good stuff, man.
It is, yeah.
I'm opening this one.
But you don't need this. You don't need this.
No, you don't. You can use any type of sugar you want, but...
Yeah, we're keeping it. We're keeping it affordable.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah, that is a good product.
That is awesome, man. All right, rad. And then... This is pretty interesting. So coconut water, it's basically a dehydrated coconut water and microbes love it.
Oh, it's such a great prebiotic.
Exactly, yeah. So it's mostly sugar, but it's made out of coconut, so
Can
it's gonna be good.
Some?
Sure, man, yeah, have as much as you want.
Wow.
Have it.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, that's gonna be pretty strong. It might be sweet. What is it, like coconut candy?
Wow. It is sweet, but it's salty too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sweet, man.
You can taste the minerals for sure, wow.
Epic.
That's wild.
Okay. And we already added the EM1, but I'll just put a little extra splash of some EM1 in there just to make sure it's all covered, see?
Okay.
All right, now that
and
is
no
going
more
to be...
water?
No, we're going to add a lot of water to
this.
We are
going to add water, okay.
So now this is going to be a really amazing KNF once we got it all together, you know?
It already
and,
smells so good.
Yeah. So the microbes are going to be going crazy in there. Yeah, it smells... What is it?
Dude,
it smells like wine or something.
Dude,
wine.
It has such a good fermented odor. What a combination.
Yeah, amazing. So... This one we can let sit for a lot shorter period of time because it's already got the
sugar.
This
one check back in a week.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So
for sure, that was a high octane recipe.
I'm gonna put a label on this. This is a KNF,
an SS,
FPJ,
SS, super Seth.
Yeah.
Supercharged.
So you'll notice on, you know, with KNF, everyone has these three-letter acronyms: KNF, Korean Natural Farming; FPJ, Fermented Plant Juice. We'll say this
L-A-B.
Is... Yeah, L-A-B, Lactobacillus bacteria. Mm-hmm. This is F-P-J with sugar on 6/11. Okay, sweet.
I would put S-S.
Well, I already know
Super
who made
Seth.
It.
Yeah. This is a uniquely high-octane blend.
Yeah. This is going to be a nice, unique
there's
one.
There's umpteen variations of this that could probably be done at lower cost still. Yeah. I mean, what do you got? A few dollars maybe in the
exactly.
actual...
Yeah.
I mean, the sugar was free.
I'd say the EM1 is probably the most expensive part of this, and that's just because it's, you know, it's a concentrated fertilizer.
Right.
So a lot of people go in there and they'll, like, massage it in with their hands. That's not how I roll. I'm not going to do that. I'm sure the microbes all get to know each other and they'll all get to, you know, moving around
moving
and eating
around.
Each other.
Yeah, it'd be neat to study this stuff.
Yeah. Exactly.
Under a scope and see all the action.
I'm going to grab the stuff I recently made. All right. So this is from, I think I made this 4 days ago or so.
This is a sugared batch.
Yeah. So this has sugar in it, so it shouldn't take quite as long. So let's just see how it did down here. Oh yeah. It's definitely not done.
Mm.
But you can see, ooh, and you can smell that it's,
We've got some bugs in there too.
Yeah, it's breaking down slowly but surely. I think I need to mix it around a little more and that might get it to keep moving, but I'll probably come back to this in 3 more days and it'll be usable at that point. But what you do, or what I would do...
Let me smell, let me get it.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. It smells good though.
It does.
Yeah.
I mean, you want it to stink eventually. Eventually it's gonna start being rancid and that's when you use it. But
you want the ammonia-like smell.
What I do is I just put this here and then pour all the water out, see?
Oh.
You can separate that, all that water that's down there.
You actually want that out of there?
The water.
You want excess water out of there?
No. I would use that water as the FPJ.
Right now.
In 3 days. So in 3 days' time, what I'll do is I'll separate these. See, I'll use the plate to separate them.
Oh, okay.
And then water is what I'll water into my plants. You know, I'll put it in like a little hand watering
fermented
thing.
Fermented plant juice.
Exactly. And then
FPJ.
And that juice is what you want to use on your plants in order to give them all those microbes.
An anaerobic decoction.
Exactly. So I think I'm actually going to add a little bit more water to this.
Okay.
Give and it then a few I'm gonna stir it. Yeah.
Yeah, it hasn't gone nearly something. Anaerobic yet. It's still way too sweet. Way too sweet.
It smells good.
It smells yeah.
It's
exactly.
not supposed to smell good.
No,
but
you
it's
want
done.
You want the nar-nar.
Exactly. Yeah. What it's done is supposed to be
yeah,
gross.
Yep.
They say stink in, stink out. So if you put gross KNF on your soil, you'll get really stinky buds at the end of the year.
Yeah.
You want stinky in a good way at the end, but stinky in a bad way at the beginning.
Nice. The exact opposite of good aerobically activated compost tea, which you want that to smell sweet and earthy. He's got his bamboo mix ready to go.
High-tech bamboo.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. All right, so I'm just mixing that around. It's really gross. And that's gonna make a really concentrated solution. See how it's like almost all plant and then there's just like water just barely covering the surface of it?
Yeah.
That's gonna be super, super, super concentrated. So some people say you dilute this 1 to 1,000 with water, or maybe 1 to 500 with water, depending on you know how actually strong you think it is.
The juice that you extract.
Exactly. You dilute it very heavily, you know.
It reminds me of like Bach flower essences, you know, just a few drops.
Right.
Homeopathy, you know, where it becomes stronger when you dilute it more.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Interesting. I don't even know about that.
There are some parallels to that. Yeah. Yeah. Arnica, for instance, when it's more diluted in homeopathy, it actually works. You know, 600x dilution instead of 60x is actually a lot stronger.
Whoa.
Yeah, it's vibrational medicine is how homeopathy kind of works.
Nuts.
So there's some vibrational energy with your KNF. Yeah, look at that. It
smells like apple cider, kind of.
Dude,
really interesting.
That seriously smells good.
It smells great.
And nothing in there right now wouldn't be beneficial.
Oh, yeah. No, this is good the whole way through.
I could drink some of this.
Yeah, everything in here is edible. Right?
Very
I guess, except for the insect crash, which is kind of gross.
And what about the KNF stuff itself?
Oh, the EM1 stuff?
I mean, the EMF one.
Yeah.
The EMF itself is questionable.
Yeah, it might be gross. I'm not going to.
It wouldn't get you sick, though.
No, it's just a bunch of shit.
The frass, any other frass is pretty. That's kind of weird.
Yeah. Frass is gnarly.
Yeah. But it wouldn't hurt you.
No, probably not. And I bet, like,
I'm not gonna
if you had
it.
Intestinal problems or something,
it might even help.
I would consider it.
Yeah.
If I had intestinal problems.
Right.
That's what they feed to chickens when the chickens
exactly,
have intestinal problems.
Exactly. Big time. It helps them so much.
All right. So we're going to let this sit for a week. And I'll film it when I come back to it, and I'll let you know how it goes. And I'll also send the video to JK so he can
there
post
you go.
This video
we'll
as well.
Have a report.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because this is all on behalf of you, Mr. Kohler.
Yeah.
Yeah, proud to present this Super Seth tech right here.
Yeah, man. Oh, dude, speaking of Super Seth tech, let's check in on the Oystercado tech last time.
Dude,
let's check it out.
The vermigasm.
That's actually right here. So
the vermigasm.
I'm going to try to not step on any of these things we just pulled out. But here, Leah, come check this out. You see where the zoom is on that? We're going to...
Look at this.
All right, so
this little shell.
This oyster was filled with avocado and... your vermi chow,
the CVC
that Josh is currently developing. Let's see how it's doing under there. Oh yeah.
Oh my God, look at that. That is a vermigasm.
That's
right
crazy
there,
yeah,
dude.
They're having
look
a full-on orgy down there, and what they do is they create a little biofilm around themselves, so they're all just in here creating babies, you know, and they're going to reproduce and they're going to go throughout the soil.
That's a vermi factory. That's a little breeding heaven.
So all that is just...
go over that again. You took an avocado.
Avocado.
You mashed it into the oyster shell?
JK mashed it up in a bowl with a little bit of your CVC and then a little bit of worm chow that I just had sitting around and just scooped it into the oyster shell, placed it face down, and then like a quarter inch to a half inch of soil or like whatever, just a little mulch on the sides so that the worms... don't see sunlight when they're getting into it, because worms don't like sunlight.
And the stuff called worm chow, not the CVC chow, that's basically just a cornmeal.
It's like corn and multivitamins for your worms.
Oh, okay.
It's
so
really...
vitamins are in there.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay, so
it's bulk.
Course, I mean, I have the nutritional yeast is in the CVC.
Yeah.
So they got a whole lot more organic vitamins.
Right.
From the brewer's yeast. I think they really like the brewer's yeast.
They do.
Something tells me they love it.
And also in brewer's yeast, there's trace elements like copper.
The copper,
and things like that, which will really bring out the terpenes in your cannabis plant.
That's true, yeah. So if the worms are pooping that brewer's yeast influenced diet, you know, if that's evolved form of copper that your plants then take up.
Yeah.
Holy smokes.
And for all the growers out there, a lot of the time you'll see like terpene infusion bottle, and you'll be able to like buy a bottle of like stuff that says that it's going to make terpenes in your plants go crazy. And really what that is most of the time is sulfur, copper, and maybe like a little bit of iron and maybe a little bit of calcium, magnesium. But like generally you're just paying for water, and what you should really do is get a more sensible product like a, you know, like a brewer's yeast or whatever has naturally occurring copper and the good stuff that's going to bring out the terpenes. Like, you don't need it in the bottle.
You could you could add some garlic for the sulfur.
Yeah, yeah. Anything in that family. What's that family called?
I
forget.
It's on the tip
Something, I don't know. Whatever. Yeah. Either way, things like onions, shallots, garlic, whatever, anything
whatever
like that.
Family's cold, exactly.
You can add that in for your sulfur.
And then maybe even a bit of Epsom salts for shits and giggles.
Yeah, for some magnesium.
If you're trying to make the mineral content higher.
No, that's a good call. I've heard people having great results where they just, when they're going to do a foliar feeding, they just sprinkle in a little bit of Epsom salt for the magnesium.
A little goes a long way. Like a salt on food.
Low and slow with the magnesium. So
but
anyway.
So that's probably why they're, that's my hunch, but I know that Brian from Organic Solution told me years ago when we traded him a load of black soldier fly for us, and he just was amazed, you know,
really?
How his worms love that.
That's
you know? So there's actually two different kinds in there.
Okay.
And now we have that fresh frass.
Yeah, yeah.
That I got from this lady, which is scary how potent it smells.
Really?
Yeah,
oh man, I want
to
give you a
try. I forgot to bring you some.
Next time.
Yeah, it's sitting there.
Rad, dude.
So it went from famine to feast with the frass. We had no frass, and now we have like three kinds.
Yeah.
You know, the down to earth, which is like super chitin looking, really lightweight, but all exoskeletal looking kind of matter. You know,
really
like
cool.
pupil shells.
Exactly.
Really cool looking, like mineral rich. Chitin rich.
Yeah.
And then we have the protein dense one, the EnviroFlight one that John connected us with EnviroFlight.
Right.
And then we got this fresh stuff recently.
Yeah.
Which you were saying that, like on Instagram, they're all begging for fresh frass.
Yeah. I hear a lot on Instagram and YouTube about how, like, you know, fresh frass is way better. It's probably got more microorganisms in it, and it's like it's had less time to just decay and dry out and stuff.
I think the legality of a packaged frass, like the one we got from Entera, it was composted.
Yeah.
And I think that's because it's black soldier fly poop, and it has everything,
right.
You know, when it's that fresh.
Mm-hmm.
So there might be coli levels, but what they're not telling you is the fresh stuff also has, if it has some E. coli, it's also going to have way more of dominator beneficial ones, you know. But of course, the powers that be, the regulatory, les petits fonctionnaires, bureaucracy, mandates, I think. So that might be, you know, a point of concern.
Sure.
And I think what your neighbor's doing and making it themselves, and what Living Web Farms, that wonderful YouTube university that mostly women powered, living soil nerds out of the East Coast. I think one of the Carolina states, they have some. Yeah, we should post the link.
Sure.
And John have it, put the link to the Living Web Farms series on black soldier fly production in your own backyard. Because I think long term, that's just like you have your own, but you have a neighbor next door spoiling you with more frass than he can already out of his. So you're harvesting these resources from the hood.
Totally, man.
Yep.
All right, Rad. Yeah. Well, let's sit down and chat garden stuff, man.
All right. All right, so that was a pretty awesome little Super Seth supercharged mini garden tour. And it's an honor to do it with you and participate here. Like I keep saying, I can't repeat that enough. What's up with this Chapin sprayer that you've got sitting over here?
Well, first of all, I'm honored that you and John have, you know, taken me under your wing and, you know, come to my garden and shown it off. I feel like really blessed that you guys are here and that his audience is even interested. I mean, this is just my hobby, but I love doing it and I love showing it off. So
we connected like a healthy mycorrhizal web of life, with the fungal messengers and in the right place at the right time.
Exactly. So this for all the living soil nerds out there, if you want to get really nerdy
and be loyal to your soil,
if you want to be loyal to the soil, and you read
look at this.
You read everything Coots writes and you watch all his videos, then you know he loves the Chapin sprayer. So this is like the high quality version of like a hand water, you know what I mean? Like it's all metal parts, and you can put like some of your fertilizers in here, you know, like you can put a wetting agent in here, you can put anything in here, and it'll just spray it right out. Like, they're made for like very heavy duty things, and so, you know,
industrial concrete sprayer.
Exactly. Like, if you want, like,
you'd find that at Harbor Freight, maybe.
Yeah. Oh yeah. They must have these at Harbor Freight.
Yeah,
but anyways.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
And you, and that's right, that's now being rock solid for you.
Never had an
the,
issue.
The nozzles are easy to clean.
Big time. I've never cleaned them, man. They're fine.
Yeah. And so you would put like your K&F for,
I guess you could.
Right. And dilute it.
I put
right?
anything in there, yeah, and just spray it out onto the soil.
So
when
your plants get a dose of Super Seth's vitamin L, the love, mm-hmm, it comes through this.
A lot of the time, either through my garden hose, or if I'm being a little bit more particular, or I'm feeding the mother plants, which are inside, mm-hmm, then I'll use this Chapin sprayer, you know?
What about one of those silly little plastic hose end sprayers?
Those are good too, man.
You like to use those occasionally?
I've used those in the past, but this year I'm trying to go as much metal and as little plastic.
There you go.
As possible.
Well said.
Thanks,
someone,
man.
Someone should make a much better version of a hose end sprayer.
Yeah, yeah.
There's got to be a market for,
I'm sure,
a really good quality metal can hose end sprayer.
Yeah, man.
You should find one.
No doubt.
Yeah.
So the other thing we wanted to talk about is that all of the GYGers, the loyal GYGers, have seen TD's amazing grow series, both the first year you did it and the second year, right?
Loyalty over royalty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
TD did an amazing job growing some excellent living soil cannabis, and Josh has been kind enough to bequeath some of that onto me, and as I've been using it...
Don't thank me, thank TD.
Sure, I'll thank
yeah,
both you guys.
Yeah, yeah.
As I've been using it, I've been finding little seeds in the bag. And so this is a TD's Gorilla Glue number 4 bag seed plant. Oh, it's falling over a little bit in the wind, but I've been having it inside,
dude,
so it's not used to the wind.
The GG4.
Yeah, it's so bomb. Oh my God.
Yeah, like...
It's crazy.
Dude, I came across... He donated some for a year and a half. It's aged so well.
That's crazy.
18 months. I mean, apparently...
18 months is so long.
Right, but I mean, it's still so potent.
I know.
You tried it, and you got seeds out of it.
Dude, it...
Yeah.
It smokes like it's hash.
Right, I mean...
It smokes like it's hash. It's crazy,
it's ridiculous,
man,
how good it is.
I shared a doobie.
Aged,
that,
you know? It's supposed to be funky. Yeah. I mean, it's starting to lose some of its curb appeal.
Oh,
a bit
for
more
sure.
Yellow,
you can
know?
Sell it in a club, for
but
sure.
Yeah?
No, I don't think you could sell
no,
it.
You no, couldn't, no, you couldn't, no, but... They say that aged weed can, mm-hmm, can have some,
yeah,
you know, there's a whole cult.
Dude, tie sticks.
Right?
That's what a tie stick is.
Is aged.
Well, what they
and
did was...
And apparently when it's aged right, apparently it can improve.
Yes. So what they did with tie sticks,
apparently,
they would take a bunch of the tie bud and then they'd take the big tie fan leaves and they'd wrap it really tight around the tie buds and then they'd like seal it off on the ends and then they'd let that sit in a box for like a year. And then you unroll it, and it's like this, like, it's not fermented, but it's like this aged thing.
Perfect humidor.
And it's different. Like, it smokes different. It tastes different. Mm-hmm. It's got a different effect on you. So,
right, different effects. Different.
Yeah, for sure.
Wow.
Which is pretty rad.
Yeah.
But yeah, so, you know, if you had some of that TD Gorilla Glue 4, you couldn't sell it in a club. But honestly, to me, it smokes better than most of the stuff I find in the club.
Exactly. And what's up with the clubs, dude?
Okay,
and all the crap that you... I mean, there's no good living soil weed.
Yeah.
In these dispensaries.
There are very few. Yeah, there are very few.
It's so hard to find, like, proper sun-grown, and the proof is always in the terpene pudding.
Yes.
Right? I mean, we were just talking about that, you know, dry-farmed with biological farming methods.
Yeah.
Come on. So it doesn't get better.
Exactly.
I mean, how can you beat that?
The issue with the club is that you've got really boring genetics. Like, everyone's going to grow a cross of runts, everyone's going to grow a cross of Skittles, everyone's going to grow a cross of the same old genetics we've all had, which I just named a bunch of whatever
it is that year.
Exactly. There's always going to be
some
every person has, and you're rarely going to find a truly unique one. Like, you could not go to any club in the area and find a Thai native strain. You just couldn't. You couldn't find Freak Show. You couldn't find any of this, you know?
Well,
and
then
so
how is that a club experience when it's just the canned...
That's the butter.
The same of everything. Whatever the pop culture
flavor
of the year is,
yeah,
or multiple flavors.
Mm-hmm. And beyond that, they're probably all using the same boring dedrients in their soils.
So much dedrient.
And they're not using soil. Right. They're not using soil. They're probably growing in rock wool, which is totally inert and totally lame and boring. And when all of the cannabis clubs smell the exact same, you can imagine that that's because they're all using the same fertilizers, mm-hmm. which give them the same terpenes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's the same across the board. Everyone has like a race to the bottom where they buy the same fertilizers, the same genetics, the same lights, down to the same humidifiers. Just there is a formula that people go to the club mm-hmm. and they have this dedrient formula that they follow. Mm-hmm. And maybe they can produce a pound for $60.
Right.
Big whoop. No one wants your crappy $60 pound. What they really want is to taste the cannabis. They want to feel the cannabis in a unique way. They want to have like an experience, you know what I mean? Like when I tell people that what I'm growing is native to Thailand, they're like, whoa, dude, I've never even heard of that. Like, I thought everything was a hybrid of a hybrid of a hybrid these days, but no, it doesn't have to be.
You know? I mean, come on, vegetable farmers are so proud of, you know, their Thai peppers, yeah, right? Yeah. You know, hot chocolate Thai pepper or mm-hmm. whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why wouldn't people embrace? And that's the beauty of cannabis,
mm-hmm.
is the diversity of
it. It's a lot like tomatoes, you know? Like, you can go to the grocery store and you can buy a big red beefsteak tomato for $1, or you can, you know, you can grow your own and you've got all these bizarre purple Cherokee style, you know, things that you just don't see very often.
Or that unique lettuce that you have.
Yeah,
the one you can't even identify, the freckle lettice. Yeah.
I'll come up with I'll find the name for that, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. So what about these farmers? Like, what is it going to take to educate them? Because you're still the minority.
Right.
I mean,
you know, I don't know.
When I went to that Living Soil, the Soil Life Summit, mm-hmm. it was, you know, a couple of hundred soil nerds,
mm-hmm.
but it felt more like such a minority was the vibe, you know? Mm-hmm. What's it going to take? I mean, these people are all so addicted to their formulaic approach.
I think educating consumers, man. I mean, if people really understood that non-organic fertilizers are literally made from petroleum byproducts.
Right, oil and gas.
Yeah. I don't think the average person internalizes that while they're smoking their flower. It's like that flower was made from the stuff that spits disgusting black sludge out of the exhaust pipe of a car. I mean, it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same exact,
mm-hmm.
you know, whatever, parent material mm-hmm. for both things.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, the consumers need to be educated. The clubs need to stop just pushing THC. Like, if someone walks into your club and they say, oh, I want something with 35% THC in the flower, then you say, wait, why do you want that? Is it because you want to have a psychedelic effect? Because that's not necessarily the best way to have a psychedelic effect. Do you want to relieve pain? Because that's not really the best way to relieve pain.
Right.
Counting the number percentage of THC is totally irrelevant. Like, I don't, when I buy beer at the store, I don't say, oh, well, this beer is 11% and this beer is 5%. Like,
right.
I just want the 11% beer. Like, the 11% beer is disgusting.
Right,
and
right.
a 35% THC cannabis, that sounds like an anxiety attack just waiting to happen.
Right,
like,
it could be.
I like some 16, 17% high THC, that means.
Right.
16 or 17% THC, some high terpenes, tons of the CBD, CBN, all that good stuff. You know, the unique tasting stuff. That's mm-hmm. what I'm after. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, what will it take to answer your original question? I think educating the consumer comes first. Educating the club is a close second. And then just
they're just going to put that demand on the farm. Then the demand will be placed on the farmers
mm-hmm. you hope.
To please not produce chemical crap.
Exactly. And the same old boring genetics grown the same way, under the same lights, blah, blah, blah. You know?
I would love John's viewers to post some of their thoughts.
Yeah,
on your diversity campaign.
Yeah, for sure.
You know?
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Put it in the comments section. We'd love to take a look and just see, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I'm always What's curious out what there? Other people have to say. Yeah.
And some of the old timers out there, I'll bet you know that Thai stick.
Yeah. I'd be curious. I've never got my hands on one, but yeah. I'd be very curious. I might try to make one, man. Wouldn't that be cool?
Oh,
with just Thai native?
I'm,
I could when totally I heard
you,
when
I, yeah, I would love to have one reincarnated by you. That would be,
wouldn't that be
I would love to celebrate that. Yeah. And that one's going to be a real full termer. Are you scared of how tall she's going to get?
I've thought about it. I mean,
you haven't topped her.
I topped her once. Yeah.
Well, she's already been topped. That's why she's got those four heads.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
five heads.
Yeah, man. Craziness.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, as John keeps coming back and checking in on the plant, we'll see how it goes. I'm not opposed to topping it again, maybe even two more times or something, you know?
Only because of this backyard and not wanting it to, because like,
I don't know. I mean, I don't know if my neighbors care. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, imagine if you just
let it
became
rip.
Like a tree. Just let it rip. It would be rad.
That'd be sick. I'll try it, dude. I don't know.
Hey, express your feelings.
Yeah, yeah. Let me know.
Should he keep topping, and or should he just go for?
Yeah.
Rocket height.
Dude, I might just go for rocket height. That I think
you might want to, man. I don't know. Be careful what you wish for.
What if I had like a 30-foot Thai plant in my backyard? How crazy would that be?
Let me see it,
dude,
Super
are
Seth.
You down?
I'm totally down.
That could be rad.
Yeah, let's do it.
Well, let's see. When JK is back here in like 3 months or something, then we'll really know.
Let's get his blessings.
Yeah, man. Yeah, we'll see what he thinks.
Yeah, he asked me for one of TD's. You know, I got a couple of TD me down plants. Mm-hmm.
I have some for John as well. Yeah, I'm going to give him some.
Yeah, and then I donated them to another local Boogie customer, and I'm proud of him for taking them. They were blueberry cupcake and blueberry muffin and vanilla cream pie.
All Humboldt seed.
All Humboldt seed,
That's awesome, man.
This freak show, man.
The freak show is rad, dude. It's so cool.
And that just came out.
As far as I know. I don't know. I've never seen it.
That's news to me. I love how you're so connected. You keep an eye on everything. You got your finger on the pulse of so much. It makes it stoner proof for me.
Right.
I get to know how to do things better. Right. What to use, what not to use. This is our new R&D. Make it happen, Boogie Captain. Right.
Thank you, man. I'm honored. Man. Yeah. Really, I love it. It's fun.
What do you think about using the ingredients that are in the CBC, not just as a worm food, but also concurrently? To me, it looks like it might be the ultimate, like, your level of salt and pepper style, low and slow, occasional top dress.
Well, just look at the ingredients.
Right,
I mean, the ingredients are everything you would want in an ultra concentrated top dress.
Very concentrated.
It is. There's no BS in there.
Right.
There's no corn. We're not shipping corn halfway across the United States. Or whatever, you know what I mean?
I was paranoid about it not meeting Super Steve C level of approval, you know, like no animal slaughterhouse byproducts, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I saw you look at the ingredients in like the down to earth vegan mix, and then you look at the numbers, and that's like what, 322 or, and then the neem seed meal is more nitrogen, but you add in all that brewer's yeast.
Mm-hmm.
And then I know that frass, well, its numbers tend to be more nitrogen, but here's the thing, frass really stimulates flower formation.
Right.
You know, so I have a sneaky suspicion that by accident, this vermi super supplement chow that John, you know, pretty much insisted, Boogie Brew needs to develop this, otherwise...
He was right.
Well, yeah, but I have a feeling that it actually can play, that might actually be second fiddle to what it could also be, which is a really good replacement for a lot of top dressing products.
Dude,
we might have inadvertently created an amazing top dress. Like,
it's like a terpene booster because it's got the brewer's yeast, it's got the insect frass, it's got a bunch of good stuff that is going to lead to
I bet if you added the best deal you can find on Amazon, Super Seth style, mycorrhizae.
You
know, like a bulk, you know, flakes.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need the powder. If you're doing it SS style, you know, if everything's breaking down, like you put your finger into that soil and it's just melting all the ingredients. So the cheaper flakes of the Mycos, right?
Mm-hmm.
Find the best deal on a bulk Mycos style dominator, like the Glomus intradices and the so I can't pronounce those species.
the four
ones that are, you know, and the thing is that the reason those are oftentimes included in an intelligently engineered top dress product is because increasing fungal activity like that with bloom specific food does help tremendously with phosphorus conversion. Like,
rad.
It does help. And then I know frass does that. So I have a feeling that if you took CVC, but see, do the worms need a bunch of mycorrhizae? No.
Probably
and,
not.
And I, also, I need it.
But the plants would like it.
Yeah, but so you do that as well. Like, that should be advised. Like, maybe I should put that on the label. You know, optional.
Yeah.
Add your favorite mycorrhizal powder if you're using CVC as a sort of early bloom. Like, following the 9/11 rules, you know, waiting for those numbers to dip in your raging. I can see trying that on, since you're already using CVC in the vicinity of this oyster vermigasm dome next to the Thai, you know.
Yeah.
I can see extending that, and that Thai girl, she's gonna get really hungry.
Mm-hmm.
And I bet adding you know, CVC to her,
mm-hmm.
right? You see what I'm saying? And
adding
a bit of the mycorrhizae too. Like, she's gonna want
that. Dude, that'd be so
cool. Yeah. 30 footer. Supercharged,
we'll
you know.
I'll see what I can do.
Yeah, you know, with this KNF and then also with the T's.
Yeah.
You know, low and slow. Oh yeah, I'm speaking of low and slow, I know We have the Grizz episode up.
Yeah. Oh, it's up.
Yeah, Rad. From Soil Life, Rad. You know, so part four. And that, out of everyone that was interviewed, Grizz is actually his secret favorite guy out of all
Grizz
of them.
Yeah, Grizz was a great interview, man.
And because he said it, right? Low and slow. Yeah. Like, you've adopted that.
So what Josh is talking about is when he went to the Soil Life Summit, he interviewed this dude named Grizz, who turned out to be a very knowledgeable person on all things living soil, and yeah, he's also got Pure Anywhere clothing and stuff. He's a total badass, and I learned a lot from his interview. So, you know, now I'm on the low and slow train, man. I'm just like just a little bit of something every once in a while. You don't need to get super intense. You don't need to overfeed your plants. Like, I know on that first episode, John Kohler showed off all those fertilizers that I have. But sometimes, man, I'm taking like a teaspoon or a tablespoon. I'm just mixing that into my compost tea. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not grabbing like the whole thing and just dumping it on the soil. Like, I'm low and slow about it because that's how the plants like it.
Less is more.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's very chill.
You're giving them so much love more than bin of ingredients. I mean, every good grower will have stuff, you know, a corner of their garage populated with all the good stuff. You know, What's in your storage bins?
Yeah,
you know?
For real.
Yeah, what out there? I mean, Coast of Maine, Boogie Brew,
good,
of course.
Yeah, of course.
You find these good brands, and loyalty over royalty.
No doubt.
You know, you stick with the stuff that works. Success leaves clues. Follow Super Seth's Super Clues here.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, man. Thanks for checking this out.
One last thing before we do that. Check this out. Last time JK was here, we planted this right here. This is the water spinach that I planted last time John was over.
Oh, JK planted it with you?
I just did like I'm doing right now. I just pulled this to the side and planted this water spinach. So it had a little bit of transplant shock, and now it's up there, man. It's rocking. So JK says this has the potential to grow 4 inches a day. So when this thing gets moving, I might have a lot of water
spinach. When it's Super Seth, supercharged, in full mode. Well, we got to document all this.
Hell yeah. Yeah. So anyway,
you've got the ultimate lab back here, bro.
Yeah, man. This is sick.
This is so sweet.
So yeah, shout out to John Kohler. Thank you for letting Josh run the show. The inmates are truly running the asylum this episode
today.
Yeah. So yeah, I love it. Thanks for watching Growing Your Greens. I'm a longtime fan, so I'm really thrilled to be homies with John and Josh. And I'm sure, you know, maybe John will do an outro, but thanks for watching, and see you guys on the next one, man.
Till then, keep on growing.
Yeah.
All right, what's up, guys? We are back. This is 8 days later after me and Josh filmed that video where we made the FPJ, the fermented plant juice. Now I've got it here. This plate was in there the whole time and it was keeping it anaerobic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pour the liquid off, and that liquid is what you're after. You can put the rest of it in the compost, but we'll take the liquid. There we go. Smells really bad. Pretty gross, but I'm gonna use this and I'm gonna dilute it and I'm gonna use it as a soil dredge. Once that's all out of there, all right. So I think most of that's out of there. I'm gonna throw the rest on the compost pile. All right, so I've poured the FPJ off, so now I just have all the liquid from that 5 gallon bucket. I'm gonna take it, put it in my little garden, you know, little hand waterer. And then, this stuff is teeming with microbes. The soil will really appreciate this. So I'll dilute it way down. I should probably mix it. So I'm gonna go grab a mixer for this. All right, so I've got the Bamboo Tech mixer. So I'm gonna spin that around to make sure that the microbes in the solution are evenly distributed. All right, so I've diluted this FPJ. See, it's about a 20-to-1 dilution. So I'm just gonna pour it here on the soil around this cannabis plant. See, this has been mulched with fresh leaves and stuff like that. And I'll just give it a little FPJ. The flowers around here will also appreciate it. See, I've got some beneficial flowers surrounding this plant right here. And there's a tomato over here, I'll get that. Some tomatoes back here. Make sure they get some. And yeah, I'll probably end up watering this in as well. All right, thank you guys for watching. If you are interested in Korean natural farming and you want to learn more, you can check out a guy named Chris Trump. He makes great videos all about KNF. And then there's also a company called Fermented Plant Extracts. And the guy that runs that company, Miles, he does some great interviews where he talks all about different Korean natural farming methods. So yeah, check that out. keep on growing.
All right, so what did you think of that episode? You rather have me in the episode or Josh in there doing the hosting? I don't know, let me know down below. I was out of town, so Josh filled in for me, so I'm grateful Josh was able to do that. And don't forget, be sure to visit Josh's channel. Josh has his own YouTube channel that I've been poking at him for like years to put more videos up. And he's finally doing it. He's going over to TD. He went to some amazing Living Soil conference and filmed all kinds of amazing interviews over there. Link down below to Josh's channel. I want you guys that are super hardcore to check his channel out, because there's lots of good info that you'll be missing out on if you don't check it out. Anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode at Super Seths, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up. More importantly, share this video with other people that can learn about the Korean natural farming techniques that Seth shared in this episode. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss my new and upcoming episodes of Commander every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as many videos come out. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. Past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,700 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teaching you guys all about how to grow your own food at home. I'll put links down below to some of the other videos I've done here at Super Seth's Place for this growing season. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.